So in this session, I'm going to talk about recurring general journal entries. Recurring general journal entries are used in two ways. One, of course, based on the naming convention, is it's your recurring entries you do over and over and over throughout the month. You could also use it for your accrual entry if, in fact, you do accrual postings. So I'm going to show you an example of both. So let's go right to it. Because I don't have it in my menu, I'm going to do a search for it. I'm going to type in recurring general. And as I start typing, it's type as you find. And lo and behold, I have my recurring general journal. As I mentioned in prior sessions, batch name, it always has a default, but you could actually create as many different batches as you want to segregate your entries based on the type of entry. You don't have to, but it's nice to keep it clean and segregated. So in this case, I'm going to do another payroll example. And I'm just going to call this payroll. Click OK. Now I'm in my payroll batch. The difference between a general journal entry that you may have seen in prior sessions and a recurring general journal is these first two columns. The recurring method, you have fixed variable balance, reverse and fixed variable balance. Fixed means that the dollar amounts, when I create my journal entries, the dollar amounts will be fixed. They stay there. You can still override them, but when I post a journal entry, just keep the amounts stagnant. Leave them there. Variable will be just the opposite. It's going to zero out the dollar amounts. And again, it's going to force the user to enter the actual dollar amount. So that's the simplistic way of doing it. Balance is when you want to do allocations, if in fact you do allocations. And I'm going to do a separate example session on that. And then, of course, we have reverse and fixed, reverse and variable. Same thing. The fixed and variable has to do with the dollar amounts. But the reversing part of it means the system's going to automatically reverse it the very next day, hence your accrual. So I'm going to show you an example of both. So let's go. My first example is going to be fixed. Okay, so that's the first column. The second column is recurring frequency. How often does this happen? Because what you're doing is you're building the template. These entries, these lines and entries you create are going to stay here. They're never going to go away unless you physically delete them out or make them expire. So how often does it happen? Because this is payroll, it could be maybe I just want to track, I want to post my payroll expenses once a month, you know, before the end of the month, or I could do it weekly, bi-weekly, however you want. So recurrent frequency, the system's looking for a date calculation because what it's going to do, based on your initial posting date, your initial entry date, it's going to add specific time to it. And the time could be in days, weeks, months, etc. So if this is going to be a monthly transaction, I'm going to say every 1M for 1 month. So what it would do, if this is 10-1, then it's going to add 1 month to 10-1. If I want to do every 2 weeks, I could do 2W, and it's going to add 2 weeks. Maybe it's 15D, 15 days. So you see the recurrent frequency is always going to be a number. You need to put a number in there. And then basically the first letter of every date format, if you will. D for day, M for month, W for weeks, Q for quarter, Y for year, etc. Right? So you have the ability to create any kind of time scale, if you will. And like I said, it calculates based on your initial posting date. Okay? So let's give an example of every 2 weeks, all right, based on my initial posting date of 10-1. I need to give it a document name because I don't have my number series set up, so I'm going to mainly put that in there. And sometimes maybe you want to have your own entry number. And in this case, I'm going to say I want to post it to my checking account, and I'm going to put in, credit of 16,000. I could put it to a department code if I like to. And also here, the expiration date, I could tell it to say, hey, I want you to expire at the end of the year. And what that's going to do, okay, this expiration date is once your work date, your system date goes beyond the expiration date, the system almost treats it as it's, you know, think of it, it's invisible. Even though you physically see it, you're going to physically see it. But when you try to post it, the system's not going to read it anymore because the system's going to read, oh, wait a minute, it expired. So because it expired, I'm not going to look to post it any longer. So you can leverage the expiration date to make that that entry expire. Or once you're done, you could physically delete the batch or physically delete the lines. So let's go down here. And what I'm going to do, now you typically want to do this, but I'm going to do it just as an example to see, so you could see the difference between fixed and variable. You do want to make sure this is the same. And in this case, I'm going to go to my expense. And let's just say this is going to be 13,000. And let's just say I want to put it to admin department. I'm going to drop down. As you see, this popularly automatically fills in. 2W. And I'm just going to put in a couple other amounts. Maybe this is 500 to admin. And I'm just going to bear with me. I'm going to put another entry in here. And let's just say this is 500. And I'll do one more. So now you see my total balance down here in the bottom of my batch is zero. That's what I want to see. Otherwise, this is telling me, hey, you're out of balance. You need to, make sure you're in balance for me to post this journal entry. So I want to make sure my total balance is zero down here in the bottom. Okay. So let's take an example of this. Now, actually, you know what? I'm going to do another example too. Between the 2 weeks, and let's make this 15 days. Just so you see the difference. Now, you typically would not do this, okay? So I'm going to forewarn you. You can, certainly, that's why I'm doing this, but you typically do not. You want to make sure that your return method is all the same within the same entry. You want to make sure your recurrent frequency is all the same. I'm only doing this to show you the difference between what the system can do. But again, please note, you always want to make sure recurrent method and recurrent frequency are always the same. They coincide with each other. Okay, so let's go in and let's post. I forgot description here. Let's say paying. Payroll. Okay, now let's go into post. Successfully. Now you see a few things. One is the entries are still there, right? We didn't change anything. They didn't get deleted. If you remember in other session, the general journals automatically, once they got posted, they automatically deleted themselves. They went away, right? So with the recurring journal, they stay here. You would have to physically delete these out because you basically built a template of journal entries, right? Let's look what else the difference is. Fixed and variable. Let's look at the amount. The amount, we said the fixed amount, so the amount stayed, whereas it's variable, it all zeroed out. Now, because it's fixed, as I mentioned earlier, I could change this to another amount if I wanted to, along with all my zeros, of course. So that's the difference between fixed and variable, what it does. It has to do with the amount. Okay, let's look at the recurrent frequency, 15 days compared to 2 weeks, right? So my initial posting date was 10/1. So I said add 15 days to 10/1, well, it brought it to 10/16. In this case, it said add 2 weeks to 10/1, and brought it to the 15th. So you see the difference of basically how it calculates, okay? And again, I'm going to stress again, you typically would not want to do this. I just did this for a scenario for you to see the differences of how the system treats the calculations, okay? So that's how you could handle your recurring general journal entries. These will stay here, as I mentioned. You would have to, once you're done with them, you can either delete the batch or delete the lines, so that way they don't get posted anymore. Or you could store the lines and actually make them expire by using the expiration date on all these lines. Okay? The other thing to note, too, is the system is going to skip anything that is beyond, or yes, beyond your system date. So if today was 10-1, okay, and these posting dates were in 10-16, 10-15, 10-15, it's not going to look to post because the system date has to meet that criteria. So let me show you an example of that. And by the way, so now I'm going to go back and change it back to what I think it should be, because as I mentioned, they should all coincide with each other. Okay. And for some simplicity purposes, I'm going to go 16.5. And I'm just going to make it 5.5. So it all balances out. Okay. So now this is how it really should appear. Okay. Now I'm going to go in here in my settings and I'm going to change my work date to be 10-1. Okay. Because it's 10-1, my posting date, this is telling me in recurrent journals that I should be posting. Well, let me change this to the 15th, saying that my posting date is going to be on the 15th. So once my system date hits the 15th or after the 15th, then it will look, because it's in the journal, this only is in the recurrent journal, by the way. It's not in the general journal. General journal, you can post any time you want. But because it's in a recurrent journal, and you could have, in theory, have multiple different dates across the board, the system will only look to post your entries that meet the criteria of your system date. So if I go into here and I try to post this, it's going to say you have nothing to post. And you're going to probably scratch your head and say, well, wait a minute, I have these entries. Why doesn't it post? Well, that's because your system date is 10-1 compared. But in the system right now, in this batch, it's telling you, no, not until the 15th can you post this. So if I want to change my posting back to the 15th, for an example, I click OK. Now if I go to post, you'll see now it actually found it and it posted and it updated the dates. And you'll see my amounts updated to zero because they're all variable. So that's an example of your recurring general journals. Let's look at an example for, I'm going to switch batches and look at the reversals for your accruals. So I'm going to do reverse and fixed, or typically it's always variable, right? So we'll do reverse and variable. In this case, their frequency, as I mentioned, when it does a reversal, it reverses the very next day. Okay, so you want to make sure your initial entry is always the last day of the month. And then that way the system will automatically reverse it the first day of the following month. So the one formula that you want to use is add one day, because if my posting date is going to be the last day of the month, you want to add one day. And then bring and then have it plus CM, which means current month. Current month will always force the system to be the last day of the month that you're in, the current month that you're in. Okay, so this is an important formula to know for your accrual entries. So add one day to 10/30, right? Because my last day of the month is 10/30. And then bring it to the current month. The last day, CM is the last day of current month. And I'm just going to do 1, 2, 3. And in this case, I'm going to see what I, let's do accrued salaries again. And let's just say it's going to be a credit of $20,000. And I could do sales. And I'm going to do reversing. 1D plus CM, and I'm going to just make it a simple entry, add 20,000, sales, I want sales, okay, I'm going to make it a simple entry, again, give as many lines as I wanted to, but because this is reverse and variable, again, it's going to post on the 30th, reverse it out on 11/1, and then zero out my dollar amounts. So let's just do a quick test. If you recall, we can do preview posting, and this is going to show me, oh, nothing to post because this is 10/1, right? So let me change this because my system date I haven't met that system date just yet, right? So let's change this to 9/30, Now let's do a test. So it's going to create four entries. Okay, why four entries? I only see two entries, right? It's going to post the initial and then the reversal. So if I hit the drill down, you're going to see as of 9:30, here's my initial entry, a credit to my accrued, debit to my expense on 9:30, what I told it to, and then automatically reverse it out on 10-1, being your following month. Okay? So let's see the impact. I post. You see 9:30 down here. Successful. And you see, based on this date format, it brought it to the last day of the following month. So that way I don't have to play with the dates anymore. All I have to do is change the dollar amounts. Let's look at the account. So if I go to the account ledger entries, you'll see at 9:30, this is my actual general ledger detail entry for document number 123. At 9:30, posted a credit of 20,000. And 10-1, it reversed itself out and got it to the next month. So the net impact is zero, but the impact for the individual month did occur. So that's how you would handle your accrual entries. Thanks for watching. If we could further assist you, please reach out to us here at epcgroup.net.